Good evening. Benjamin Franklin observed that democracy is two wolves and a lamb voting on what to have for lunch. Liberty, Mr. Franklin said, is a well-armed lamb contesting the vote. With us this evening is arguably the world's leading authority on democracy. As president of the National Endowment for Democracy, since its founding in 1984, Carl Gershman is uniquely qualified to deliver this year's John B. Hurford Memorial Lecture on the topic of democratic renewal. In his commencement address at Rutgers University this past Sunday, President Obama urged the graduating class to have faith in democracy. He said the system is not as rigged as you think and is not as hopeless as you think. It is not always pretty, though, he concluded. I think Carl will concur, and like you, I am anxious to hear his prescriptions for democratic renewal, particularly in the face of the authoritarian resurgence in many parts of the world. Carl is no stranger to the Foreign Policy Association. Over the years, we have worked together, primarily under the auspices of our joint venture, the New York Democracy Forum. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming back to our forum, Carl Gershman.
Thanks very much, Noel, and it's really a great pleasure to be back here in New York and to talk to on a very special occasion. John Hurford was, when he passed away in 2000, he was a member of our board, a dear personal friend. He was a true American patriot who believed in the universal values that he believed our country needs to represent in the world, so it's just a great pleasure for me to be here in John's name. There are also a number of very special people in the audience. I want to recognize just a couple. First of all, Hilga Hurford, John's widow. Where is Hilga? She's all the way in the back, but she leads from the front, but she's in the back. And I want to introduce also Zeynep Bengura, who is a dear, old and dear personal friend, who is the Undersecretary General at the United Nations, in charge of dealing with one of the worst problems in the world, which is terrible, terrible violence against women in zones of conflict, which could be Congo, South Sudan, ISIS in Iraq. I mean, the horrors that she deals with and tries to prevent are simply horrendous. And she's an extraordinary person, and I'm proud to say that she's been elected the chair of the World Movement for Democracy, which is a global network that the NED provides the Secretariat for. And I'm also happy to, this is a surprise to me, but Andy Nathan is here from the NED board. Andy is a professor at Columbia, and he's arguably America's leading specialist on China. I'm feeling a little bit intimidated because I'm going to talk about China tonight, and I don't want to say something that Andy would disagree with, but the good thing about Andy is he seems to waver so much on where China is going that he'd probably agree with anything I said. I gave, this is the third time I'm doing this, but the first time I gave the Hurford Lecture was in March 1st, 2011, which was in the immediate aftermath of the uprising in Egypt, which led to the downfall of Mubarak. And that was, you know, a very hopeful moment. And I gave a hopeful speech. And I talked about the prospects for success and what would have to be done if, you know, democracy were to actually be achieved in Egypt after the fall of Mubarak. And I think, as we know, it has not been successful, quite the contrary, and that there are a lot of reasons for that. And I think, you know, the blame goes around. The government, the army, in Egypt never wanted change. The deep state in Egypt never wanted change. The Islamists were overreaching and illiberal and made it very, very difficult. The secular parties were divided and ultimately sided with the military because of their fear of the Islamists, and even the civil society organizations that we supported, they weren't ready for it. It was such an overwhelmingly difficult problem. It was such a dysfunctional state. And they didn't have answers to the problems of governance. And that, therefore, the revolution in Egypt failed, and Sisi today, a lot of people believe, is more repressive than Mubarak was during, you know, when, at the time that he was overthrown. And the failure in Egypt, and of course it's a broader failure throughout the Middle East, aside from Tunisia and Morocco, but the failure in the Middle East has had a lot to do with the feeling that a lot of people have that democracy is not doing well, that democracy is in trouble. There's a cover story that some of you may have seen about this in The Economist this week, where it talks about the Middle East today, 5 years after the Arab Spring, being more benighted than ever. And they not only talk about the repression in Egypt, but the breakdown of the state in Iran, Iraq, Syria, Yemen, the conflict between Saudi Arabia and Iran, and the growth of sectarian violence in the region, obviously the rise of ISIS and international terrorism, which has undermined hopes for democratic not only undermined hopes for democratic change in the Middle East, but which has given autocrats in the region a reason for really cracking down because of the threat of terrorism, and has actually encouraged the argument in this country that we shouldn't be trying to advance democracy, because all this will lead to is instability, chaos, and terrorism. And we're in the middle of a debate about those issues today. And in a way, the most troubling development to me has been the geopolitical retreat in this current context of the West, including the United States, which has not only resulted in a lot of the instability, I think, that we have, the emergence of ISIS, Iran's expanding influence in the Arab world, Putin's assault on the international order in Crimea and eastern Ukraine, and the reassertion of Russian power in the Middle East for the first time since Sadat kicked the Soviet Union out more than four decades ago, and also China's brazen projection of power in the South China Sea. These are just among some of the factors that worry many people. And the effect on democracy of the geopolitical retreat has been worsened by the fact that the West is today gripped by a crisis of identity and governance, a crisis that is partly the result of the economic stagnation that was triggered by the financial crisis of 2008, but which is rooted in systemic problems having to do with massive indebtedness, large budget deficits, unprecedented entitlement spending, and growing inequality. There is also a crisis of political dysfunction, which is exemplified in the United States by polarization and a declining trust in government, the thing that you're saying that Obama was trying to address in his remarks at Rutgers, and by the rise here and in Europe of a new populism that exploits grievance, fear, frustration, and that undermines democracy's standing and credibility internationally. And the crisis of the West has emboldened opponents of liberal democracy who are rushing to fill the vacuums that are being created by the Western paralysis and retreat. And the growing projection of hard power by Russia, China, and Iran has increased the threat of terrorism, but has obscured an equally important expansion of authoritarian influence and democratic retreat in the area of soft power. In other words, the hard power has obscured the growth of authoritarian influence and power in the area of what we think of as soft power, which is the realm of information, communications, technology, ideas, and culture, where the advanced democracies had been thought to have a natural advantage. Globalization was always thought to provide a favorable context for the expansion of democracy and liberal values. Indeed, it was assumed that in the aftermath of the Cold War, that the West could encourage the liberalization of countries like Russia and China by engaging with them and integrating them into the liberal international order. All of you know that argument. If we could have that engagement, they would become more liberal. Many believe that the attractions of our culture and lifestyle and the impact of the global economy would inevitably open up autocratic systems. But it hasn't worked out that way. Against all expectations, these authoritarian countries have not liberalized, but have grown more repressive. And far from being changed by integration into the liberal world order, they are actually trying to take over that order and to use it to advance their own interests and their own authoritarian values. We've called this, as Noel said in his introduction, we've called this phenomenon resurgent authoritarianism, and we've just come out with a book of essays on the subject called Authoritarianism Goes Global, which explains how a number of autocracies, in particular Russia, China, and Iran, but there are some others, have developed new tools and strategies in a number of areas to contain the spread of democracy in the world and challenge the democracy agenda on a number of different fronts in the soft power battle of ideas. One of these is the area of civil society. Over the last 4 years, 120 laws have been passed that repress civil society in 60 different countries, which suggests to you in 60 different countries the breadth of this phenomenon of repression of civil society. These are laws that seek to frustrate, undermine, and prohibit the activities of democratic civil society groups and individual activists who are often called foreign agents, a fifth column. Russia had last year declared NED, our organization, OSF, the Open Society, that's Soros' organization, the National Democratic Institute, headed by Madeleine Albright, and other international organizations undesirable, and have threatened NGOs that receive support from such international organizations with severe legal penalties. A new law has just been passed in China that will restrict the activities of foreign and local NGOs and to put them under the control of the Public Security Bureau because they are considered a security threat. And what China and Russia and Iran, what they really fear is what they called colored revolutions. These are like the Orange Revolution that took place in 2004 and 5 in Ukraine. The Rose Revolution took place in Georgia. The Green Revolution that took place in Iran in 2009. The Velvet Revolution that took place in Czechoslovakia in 1989, the Jasmine Revolution that took place in Tunisia. They do not want this happening, and one of the ways they're seeking to prevent it is by repressing civil society. They preempt any kind of revolution. Another area of soft power where the autocrats are becoming much more active and influential is information and media. Here, the autocrats seek to exploit the decline of the Western business model in media, which is poorly resourced, but also the enormous growth of information in social media without any filtering or monitoring of the information. So people are confused and they don't even know what to believe. And this really gives an opportunity for countries, especially Russia, to move in to try to confuse the picture further. The Russian information agenda today, which is carried out, a lot of you have probably seen it, RT, used to be Russia Today, and there are other vehicles that they have, is no longer, as in the period of the Soviet Union, to project the government's line. That's not what they're seeking to do. And to use all their different media, their web portals, and all of the trolls that they have, which create phony stories. What they what they're trying to do today is to confuse people, to undermine the confidence and credibility of leadership in the various democracies, and to advance their own objectives. So they project, you know, the Western countries as being racist. They try to inflame fears of immigrants. And, you know, they say that 9/11 was an inside job, and they promote that kind of a line, that the Zika virus is invented by the CIA, that the downing of the Malaysian airliner, the MH17, was really done by the Ukrainians because they were trying to follow a plane they thought that Putin was in. These are the kind of lines that they push. Merkel, the Chancellor of Germany, recently had her intelligence investigate the Russian use of propaganda in Germany after a fake story about a rape of a German woman by a Muslim refugee blew up into scandal thanks in part to the Russian online effort to spread these lies. We at NED have just seen a fake letter that's been circulating on the internet by an official of the U.S. Agency for International Development directed to somebody on our staff, instructing her to revise the NED plans to use NGOs in Russia, Ukraine, Belarus, and Kazakhstan to recruit people for ISIS, warning about possible congressional investigations and media controversy. Such propaganda, which gets picked up, actually, by the extreme parties on the left and the right, in Europe mostly, this propaganda targets institutions like the European Union, NATO, and you know, labels them as aggressors. The propaganda helped prepare the way for the Russian invasion and dismemberment of Ukraine through a propaganda blitz that fomented confusion about the Euromaidan, the uprising in 2013 and 2014. And the alleged fascism in Ukraine. And it was a factor in the recent referendum in the Netherlands, where the Netherlands voted on rejecting the association agreement that the European Union had signed with Ukraine. It doesn't have any real effect, but it's again part of the Russian effort to undermine any Ukrainian orientation toward Europe, which would mean that it would be leaving the Russian sphere of influence. In addition to, and there's also, by the way, and I won't go into this in great detail, but there are extensive Chinese outlets in Latin America, in Africa, and Iran has its own very extensive media outlet, Hispan TV in Spanish, Press TV in English, and other outlets in French, Arabic, Urdu, Azeri, Kurdish, and Bosnian. So this is a big effort and a clear objective of the autocrats. A third area involves countering international democratic norms by weakening the democracy and human rights mechanisms of rules-based international bodies like the OSCE, the Council of Europe, the OAS in this hemisphere, as well as bodies concerned with the governance of the internet. The goal here is to replace universal norms that are embodied in the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, which we thought were becoming established as global norms, but to replace them with new norms based on unrestricted state sovereignty and the rejection of any interference in the internal affairs through human rights advocacy of an autocratic country. Alexander Solzhenitsyn once said, there are no internal affairs left on our crowded earth, but they're now trying to reverse that and to label as terrorists that they're trying to control people who are really political dissidents. They've created their own, to advance this, these autocrats have created their own international organizations, like the Shanghai Cooperation Organization, which brings them together, the Gulf Cooperation Council, the Eurasian Economic Union. And they work to institutionalize the principles of unlimited sovereignty and non-interference in internal affairs. They reinforce the domestic repression by helping dictators share techniques of political control, watch lists of dissidents, and agreements on the refoulement of exiles returning them to China, who are called terrorists. On this basis, they seek to legitimize the cross-border abductions of foreign nationals. And just last month, 45 Taiwanese citizens who were working in Kenya were deported to China, as well as dozens of Taiwanese working in Malaysia. And there have been cross-border abductions by Chinese authorities of Chinese dissidents in Thailand. And I think, as you know, because there have been a lot of articles on this, take this. I never even use it. You've probably read about the booksellers in Hong Kong who have been abducted and taken to China because they were selling works known to be critical of China. Again, among the other norms that are being, areas where the conflict, this soft power is being asserted, is in elections. There's something in the world today, believe it or not, called zombie monitors, zombie election monitors. It's really a phenomenon where if Azerbaijan is having an election, or Zimbabwe is having an election, or Venezuela is having an election, the regimes recruit monitors from certain organizations that are friendly to the government, and they try to prohibit monitors from organizations that do real election monitoring, and then they get approval of the elections that they hold. And a final area of soft power competition is cyberspace. There was the popular sentiment some years ago that authoritarian states were technologically challenged dinosaurs that could not keep up with online activity and would inevitably be weeded out by the information age. But these regimes are proving much more adaptable than has been expected. They have prioritized control of cyberspace, developed methods to exert that control, and have marshaled resources needed to back their various initiatives for control. National level internet controls are now deeply entrenched, and authoritarian states are becoming more assertive internationally and regionally in asserting their control over the internet, promoting cyber security policies, and emphasizing concepts of state security at the expense of human rights. They have access to very, very sophisticated tools in doing this, and they engage in digital attacks on activists, espionage, surveillance, digital control over their own population, and to combat dissent originating beyond their borders. Now, what's happening today is no longer, the authoritarians are no longer really content just to contain democracy, which spread very dramatically in the 1980s and 1990s, but that they want to roll it back. And this is, of course, not the first time that democracy has been put on the defensive and that its prospects have appeared bleak. Some of the people in the audience, I know, I'm including myself here, are old enough to remember the 1970s and what happened in the 1970s when the defeat of the US in Vietnam, the reversal of democracy for 2 years in India, the collapse of a lot of democracies in Latin America, and the takeover by military dictatorships. And right before he became senator from New York, Daniel Patrick Moynihan, who was a major intellectual, wrote an article in 1976 in the National Interest, the public interest, it was a bicentennial issue, because it was the bicentennial of our Declaration of Independence. And in that article, he said, and he had been ambassador to India right before he wrote this article. He was appointed by Nixon as ambassador to India. So he was very preoccupied with the emergency that was declared by Indira Gandhi in India. And he said, democracy is where the world was, not where the world is going. And it was because of all these terrible things that were happening at the time. Now, there was no way for Moynihan to have known it, but the political scientist Samuel Huntington wrote a book in the early 1990s reflecting back where he identified the beginning of the third wave of democratization as taking place in Portugal with the downfall of the military dictatorship on April 25th, 1974. So right when Moynihan was writing, and then Franco died the following year and the transition started in Spain, and then the transition spread to Latin America, to Asia, 1989 and the fall of communism in Central Europe, and they spread to many African countries. This was the beginning of the largest expansion of democracy in the history of the world, when the number of democracies in the world more than doubled, according to all estimates. And it started right when Moynihan said, democracy is where the world was, not where the world is going. So I guess you can assume from that story that could we be, is the same thing happening today? I'm not sure, and I don't want to even, reflect on the idea that maybe we're at the beginning of a new wave of democratization, despite how bad everything it looks. And I think, in some ways, that the crisis appears to me to be more serious today than it was then. I think the West is more economically and politically weaker today than it was then. Although the 70s was a bad period, we did have the Cold War back then, which was a principle around which would at least reminded people that we had problems in the world, and you just couldn't turn your backs on that. And that's we don't have that today. But I think there are some reasons that I just want to reflect on quickly as to why the picture is not as bleak as I have been presenting it. The first is that, according to the Freedom House numbers, Freedom House does an annual survey of democracy in the world, the number of electoral democracies, and that's not liberal democracies, but countries that have basically free and fair elections and can be called democratic, they're not fraudulent elections, the number increased, I said, doubled with the third wave, and it reached a peak in 2005 of 125 countries. It remains at that number today, even though there, in many ways, there's been an erosion of liberty and democracy in many countries, but still, according to Freedom House, the number of electoral democracies remains at 125, and that's the reason that a political scientist like Larry Diamond speaks about a democracy recession, not a democracy depression. And it's why the political scientists do not feel that, according to the Huntington thesis, that democracy waves are followed by reverse waves. The first wave he identified as ending in right around the time of the First World War, and then you had the rise of Nazism and communism. The second wave took place after World War II and the expansion of the second expansion of democracy in the world. And then you had the period that I was talking about that Moynihan was so concerned about, which was called a second reverse wave. But they don't feel that we're in a third reverse wave today. I've debated that with people. I think, this is the moral equivalent of a reverse wave, but it hasn't been as dramatic as previous waves have been. A second factor, which I think is a reason for a certain degree of hope, is that there have been a number of surprising democracy successes in the past couple of years. Last March, Nigeria had a very important election. People felt it was going to be stolen. There would be terrible violence. Millions of people might even be killed in Nigeria. And yet it was an election that was successful, and that has led to a democratic government coming in that really wants to deal with serious problems like corruption. Argentina had an election last November where Mauricio Macri defeated the Peronist candidate who was corrupt, tied to Iran, and so forth. And this gave real encouragement to liberal forces in the hemisphere. The New York Times called Macri's upset victory a stunner that is likely to set in motion a transformational era at home and in the region. This is very significant. There was also the defeat the following month after that election in Argentina of the elections in Venezuela, where the Chavista party was defeated in major parliamentary elections. They haven't accepted the defeat and they're trying to fight the new parliament, but they lost overwhelmingly in the parliamentary elections. And I think it signaled a real setback for Chavista populism in Latin America. There were the elections in Burma,
which nobody really expected would be accepted by the military, and they still have control, but still Aung San Suu Kyi's party won overwhelmingly in the elections that took place in Burma in November of last year. There was the transition in Tunisia, the one I've mentioned already, the first Arab democracy, and the Nobel Peace Prize went to the National Dialogue Quartet, which were the civil society organizations in Tunisia that negotiated the constitutional compromise between the secularists and the Islamists that made it possible for Tunisia to become a democracy. There were elections in Sri Lanka where a real radical nationalist had been president, Rajapaksa, had been president in January of 2015, and he was ousted. And that defeat by the extreme Buddhist nationalists in Sri Lanka was reconfirmed in August in parliamentary elections that they weren't able to come back. And there have been democratic successes in some smaller African countries like Burkina Faso and Cote d'Ivoire. All these amount to something. It's not nothing that 8 or 9 countries have had these kinds of changes. The third reason I think that there is reason for hope is that the autocrats do not sit securely on their thrones. Their repeated warnings about the danger of colored revolutions is actually an implicit admission that what they fear most is the test of a real election that they might lose, knowing that the trigger for a colored revolution is almost always a stolen election. That's what happened in Iran in 2009. That's what happened in Ukraine in 2004. That's what triggers these things, and they don't want that. They're fearful because they know they really don't have the support. Putin has recently adopted a slate of new draconian laws targeting the September parliamentary elections. There are much harsher restrictions on monitors in Russia. There's the prohibition on people, oppositionists, popular oppositionists like Alexei Navalny, from running. They're under legal restrictions. In addition, Putin has just formed, you might have read about this in the papers just in the last month, a new kind of Praetorian Guard of 400,000 troops to be his personal guard under the leadership of the person who had been his personal bodyguard. And as the Russian oppositionist Vladimir Kara-Murza wrote recently, this does not look like the behavior of a government that has, as it claims, 89% support. And then we have China, and this is where I get nervous because I'm talking about China with Andy here. President Xi is not acting like he feels secure in his own power. He has greatly tightened political controls, making China more repressive today than at any time since Mao. Yesterday, December the 16th, marked the 50th anniversary of the start of the Cultural Revolution in China. Again, there's a really interesting report on this in the same issue of The Economist this week that I mentioned having to do with the Arab Spring. The Cultural Revolution was an absolute disaster. It was called the Spiritual Holocaust by many people in China. Over 1 million people were killed. Tens of millions were tortured and humiliated. It was a period of chaos and even madness, but nobody will talk about it today. But President Xi has started a campaign against what he calls historical nihilism, which is reflecting critically on the legacy of Mao, because what they're worried about in China is anything that would cast doubt on the legitimacy of the Communist Party. And so he has done that. He has also started a cult of Mao in China. His father, had, as Andy pointed out in an article in the New York Review of Books, was saved by Mao. Maybe there's some personal loyalty there. But he himself, President Xi, has become the target of an open letter calling upon him to resign, and also of a sharp remonstrance appearing on the website of the party, of the Communist Party's own enforcement arm, warning Xi against Xi's cult of personality, that it has gone too far. And Andy, and this I'm just quoting you, Andy, and I was going to quote you even if you weren't here, said that, who in the past, Andy has sort of talked about the resilience of the Chinese regime, but he wrote in this article that Xi's regime now behaves as if it faces an existential threat. Those are Andy's words, not mine. And also the Castro regime in Cuba, I think, has reason to worry. In the past, it has based its legitimacy on anti-Americanism and this revolutionary fervor, but all that's gone now. with the normalization of relations with the United States and the changes that have taken place in Argentina and Venezuela. And they make the Cuban dictatorship look increasingly anachronistic. And one result of that is that the Castro regime has actually, like in China and Russia, increased repression. We had a visit yesterday at the NED from one of the opposition leaders, Manuel Cuesta Murúa, who said that in less than the last 4 years, 100,000 people have left the Cuban Communist Party. So there are changes taking place. These are not secure regimes. A fourth reason for cautious optimism is that the world's poorest people over the past quarter of a century, especially over the last 20 years, have achieved unprecedented economic, health, and education advances during this period, a phenomenon that is documented by the Georgetown University scholar Stephen Radelet in his new book, The Great Surge, The Ascent of the Developing World. According to him, 1 billion people have been lifted out of poverty since the early 1990s, reducing by half the number of extremely poor people in the world to 17% of the population of the developing world from 42% in the early 1990s. There's been a dramatic reduction in child mortality, children dying less than five. In 1960, the rate was 22%. In 1990, it was 10%. Now it's under 5%. These are dramatic changes. There's been a dramatic increase in education for girls throughout the developing world. Now up to 80% of young girls who have completed primary education, up from 50% just 20 years ago. These statistics, I think, have a lot to do with explaining why the numbers that I gave you before, the 125 countries, why this change has been sustainable, and why there have been these breakthroughs that I talked about, because there is increasing wealth and well-being among people, and their demands are for a better life are increasing. And finally, the last reason is that I want to point to is what I consider to be the energy and the resilience of civil society throughout the world, not just in fragile new democracies and semi-open autocracies, but also in backsliding and increasingly repressive authoritarian countries. In Africa, they include bloggers in Ethiopia, which is an extremely repressive country, youth activists and trade unionists in Zimbabwe, investigative journalists in Angola, human rights defenders and peace activists in Burundi and the Congo. In Russia, where democratic leaders like Boris Nemtsov have been murdered, and others, Anna Politkovskaya before him, still people who are people are taking to NGOs under repression to defend human rights, to promote independent information, to challenge the regime. It's quite remarkable. This person that I mentioned before, Vladimir Karamurza, the young activist, he's a friend of mine. 1 year ago this month, after Nemtsov was murdered, he was poisoned, and the doctors gave him no chance to live. And somehow, miraculously, he survived. He is now back working in Russia. I mean, it's just amazing that somebody has the courage to continue. He works with Khodorkovsky, an exiled opposition leader. But the courage of these Russian activists is something to behold. And in China, despite the harsh political crackdown, a Freedom House study reports that people are joining rights defense activities, information is spreading despite censorship, and the fear of repression is waning. And the disillusionment with party corruption is growing. These examples are, in my view, are just the tip of a massive iceberg of civic activism that exists in all regions of the world and that may, at this very moment, be preparing the way for new democratic breakthroughs in the future. And I don't know if that's going to happen, but I think that there are three fundamental things that we need to do to try to help renew democratic progress and momentum. The first has to do with reversing the authoritarian resurgence. I mentioned here, and I'm not going to go into detail, but Congress has given our organization special funds to try to develop a strategic plan through grant making to deal with the kinds of challenges in the areas of civil society, information, democratic norms, and so forth that I discussed before. We look forward to being able to work with private foundations in this effort. Our government, both the administration and the Congress, must also do more to integrate political support for civil society and democratic freedoms into our regular bilateral and multilateral diplomacy. to strenuously defend democratic norms in international and regional rules-based bodies, and to strengthen our capacity in the area of information and international broadcasting to deal with this information threat that we face. I mean, the radios now, our surrogate radios, are really just considered to be not nearly as effective as they need to be. And there's a bill before the Congress to try to change the governance structure of our public diplomacy and our radios. And I think it's really important, it's before the House and the Senate now, that that legislation be passed to reform our radios so that we begin to organize ourselves to respond to the challenge that is at hand. We abolished the U.S. Information Agency 15 years ago. I think that was a terrible mistake, but we still need to act now to try to deal with this problem. The second priority is to restore U.S. leadership in the defense of the liberal world order that is now under attack and that is so essential to democratic progress, to political stability, and to economic growth in the world. As a leader of a bipartisan organization, it's not my job to critique our government's foreign policy. But I think a few general principles can be stated that deserve bipartisan support and that hopefully can survive what one of our board members, our other board member, Steve Sestanovich, in a book that he wrote recently, what he called the periodic swings in our foreign policy between maximalism and minimalism. We're sort of in a minimalist period right now. They include the recognition, these principles include the recognition that U.S. leadership requires the exercise of power, to put it bluntly, and that diplomacy will be feckless and ineffective if it is not backed up by credible military deterrence. I think that's a fundamental point. I'm not going to get into specific issues, but I think the point needs to be thought about and understood. They also include the recognition that while engagement, and I talked about this before, while engagement with dictatorial opponents is necessary, we should never conflate a regime that rules without popular consent with the people of a country, or fall into the mirror image trap of thinking that dictators act according to the same moral and strategic calculus as democratically elected leaders, or to assume that engagement by itself, without significant pressure and conditionality, will produce liberal change. It just hasn't, and it's not happening in Cuba today either. Finally, there is the need to find a middle ground on critical international issues between overreaching and not reaching at all, and between trying to remake the world in our own image and forgetting that there are people who share our values and who need help. Finally, at a time when people are turning increasingly protectionist, it's also important to find a better balance between promoting trade in our globalized world and doing more to protect American manufacturing jobs against imports from non-democratic and low-wage countries. For example, as a former board member of ours, Bill Galston, pointed out in the Wall Street Journal last week, by making more aggressive use of anti-dumping provisions that are in existing trade agreements. And I would also call your attention to an article in today's Wall Street Journal by another NED board member, Bob Zelick, about why the TPP, the trade agreement in Asia, is in our national security interest, and why we would make a grave mistake in our relations with Asia and dealings with China if we did not adopt the TPP. And finally, the third priority is to think about how we can restore our country's sense of its purpose in the world and to reaffirm the American founding values that have done so much to influence the growth of democracy in the world over two centuries. I've always been taken by what Abraham Lincoln said when he stopped in Independence Hall in Philadelphia on his inaugural trip to Washington in February of 1861. He said that he had, and this was all extemporaneous, by the way, he said that he had never had a feeling politically, that did not spring from the sentiments embodied in the Declaration of Independence. The sentiments involving what he was referring to, of course, was the equality and unalienable rights of all human beings, which is stated in the Declaration. He said that he had often inquired of himself, what great principle or idea it was that kept our country, this Confederacy, together for so long. And he concluded that it was that sentiment in the Declaration of Independence, which gave liberty, and this is really important from Lincoln, which gave liberty not alone to the people of this country, but I hope for the world, for all future time. That was a vision projected by Abraham Lincoln. And this is, you know, that is the source, in my view, of our greatness as a country, what we stand for, what we represent. And we will not restore that greatness, which many Americans rightly feel has been lost, by loudly proclaiming that we are great, or that we need to be great again, or by saying that we make a dangerous mistake in trying to encourage the spread of our democratic values internationally, since they are not universally shared, especially in non-Western countries. This has been said by somebody. As a matter of fact, though, with the democratic West so absorbed as it now is in its own problems, the leadership of the effort to advance democracy is now coming not from the West, but from the global democracy movement, meaning the people and organizations on the ground in one country after another, in the global South and in the post-communist world, who are fighting to defend their rights and human dignity. It is there that one hears the language today of democratic solidarity, of universal human rights, and it is my hope that by linking young people here and in Europe with young activists and others fighting for fundamental rights and freedoms in the so-called non-Western countries of the world, that this might spark a revival of democratic commitment in the countries where democracy, after many trials, first became rooted here. And think about the trials in Europe, where democracy now exists. I find it ironic that we should be in need of democratic inspiration from the very people we should be helping. But that will probably encourage humility on our part, which is actually a virtue. And we will need such humility as we try to respond to the immense challenges that we face in a very dangerous and complex world. Thank you.
Well, Carl, thank you for those very eloquent remarks. And Carl has agreed to take some questions. We'll let you call them.
Please, yeah, go ahead.
The way that one learns is by watching, not by listening to what someone says. So what should our democracy look like, and how should that be connected to something like the economic policies of government?
What should democracy look like and be connected to economic policies?
And how should it relate to economics? In this country, we now have one of our candidates, a marvelous man,
look, I don't think that these are very difficult questions. And right now our whole system is deeply divided on these questions. And it's not just on the right, but it's also on the left. And we have to think about how do we encourage economic growth. We're not going to achieve anything if we don't encourage economic growth, which can really get our country moving again. And that's going to require, you know, dealing with some of the problems that we have. Encouraging incentives for investment, taking risk. It will encourage, we need a welfare state that takes care of the poor, but we cannot substitute that for the production of jobs, which makes us competitive in the world economy. And we have to think very creatively, and I think in a bipartisan way, how we can do that together, how you can combine protection for people with the kind of incentives and the openness we need to grow. And I think that just has to be an integral part of any democratic strategy everywhere. I mean, look at, you know, why did those changes take place in the developing world that I spoke with, which are so absolutely extraordinary over the last 20 years? They took place because democracy spread and the rule of law spread. That's why they took place. And people were, despite the fact that China and Russia would not take advantage of the global economy, people were becoming more open and democratic. And we have to see that kind of openness as being very important for economic well-being and not just transfer of resources from the state to the people. Please, yes.
Concerned about the erosion of democracy in Turkey. I say I'm concerned about the erosion of democracy in Turkey.
In Turkey?
Yes, because my concern is that Turkey had a fairly robust democracy prior to the current administration. And if the democracy in Turkey can erode, is not all democracy being threatened also? Maybe we're not aware of it?
Look, the only thing I would sort of disagree with what you said was that there was a really robust democracy in Turkey before. There was electoral democracy, formal democracy. But Turkey has always been, has not been a very liberal country, not for the Kurdish minority and others, not for the media. It's been a fairly restricted country. And I agree with you that it's getting worse today. Erdogan is pretty much eliminating his opposition and becoming much more autocratic and repressive of not only the Kurdish minority, but of media freedom and opposition freedom. He too is very fearful. They had the kind of beginnings of a uprising in Turkey that he was very fearful of, and he basically is saying, we're not going to have that here, we're going to cut it off. He is, you know, very fearful of Russia today. He's very concerned about what's happening in Syria. He's got a lot of crises on his hands to deal with, but I think there's real reason to be concerned about the drift in Turkey, because it was once seen as something that would encourage change in the Muslim world, but today Turkey is no longer a model and is in fact rejected by a lot of people who believe in democracy in the Middle East. In the back, yes.
Thank you for your wonderful talk. I have my own theory, I'd like you to talk about it. I feel that countries like Turkey, Russia, Middle East, Africa, who've never had experience with any democratic government, with anything other than autocracy, will find it very, very difficult at any time, at any place, to develop a democracy, not only a liberal democracy. Do you want to comment on that statement?
Look, after World War II, when the U.S. occupied Japan, all the Japan specialists said, forget it. Japan cannot have democracy because of a Japanese culture. And democracy took root in Japan, and it took root in Germany, where people didn't have hope for it. And during the third wave, has basically swept all the cultures of the world. The one part of the world that was left out of the third wave was the Arab Middle East. It was the only part of the world that was left out of the third wave of democratic expansion, which happened in Africa. The number of democracies in Africa has gone, you know, when the NED got started, there were three countries in Africa, I think a total of 3 million people. Botswana was one, Benin was another, that were democratic. And now they're almost half the countries in Africa are electoral democracies or even liberal democracies. Senegal is a country which really is more a liberal democracy. And nobody thought this was possible before. And there are many other parts of the world. And even in the Arab Middle East, despite the failure of the Arab Spring, you now have the first Arab democracy in Tunisia. And it's a beachhead for democracy in the region. And there are people, I think, who are going to learn lessons from the failure. So I think it's a profound mistake to adopt what I would call the point of view of cultural determinism. That democracy is somehow Western? Really? Look at what the West went through. Look how many people were killed in Europe in the 19th and especially 20th centuries in the conflicts that took place before they were able to reach a democratic compromise. Look at the wars of religion where people killed each other over religion until they decided enough killing. And that may happen in the Middle East, you know, between the Shia and the Sunni. It's possible that that's a model. We're going through a very, very tumultuous time where a lot of, especially in the Middle East, a lot of traditional cultures are confronting modernity. And it's very disruptive. And globalization is very disruptive. But in the end, there is no alternative to democracy if you're going to live in peace and just not kill each other permanently. And I think the gains that have been made have been extraordinary. And I don't think they're going to be turned back. I conclude from what I said that I think that the odds are that democracy is going to continue to expand. And it's going to continue to expand because people want it. In the Middle East, they have something called the barometers, which are opinion polls taken of all the regions of the world. And there's a Middle East barometer, there's an Afro barometer, Asia barometer, and so forth. And the barometer for the Middle East shows that despite all the violence, despite all the setbacks, despite the fact that many people blame this on the openings and the push for democracy, the percentage of people in the Middle East that want democracy, which is 70%, has not diminished in the last 5 years. It's still the same. People want it. And the question is there a way in which they can find a way to live together, to make the compromises, to deal with all the divisions that they have? There are a lot of forces that are going to push against it. I have to confess that I see this as much, much more difficult now than I did when I took over the NED 3 decades ago. I thought, democracy was inevitable. Another one of our board members, Frank Fukuyama, the end of history, that liberal democracy was the inevitable. He still believes that. But even he knows now it's going to be much, much more difficult. Democracy is very, very difficult. The idea of compromise, the idea of tolerance is extremely difficult. And I think, we sort of have to find models of people who have upheld these values. I mean, one model, somebody we're going to have an event honoring on he passed away, but October 5th is the 80th anniversary of his birth, Václav Havel. And somebody once said that he was able to combine courage with tolerance, these two qualities. And to understand that, to think about it, to think about what we need in this country to live together. I mean, we're so deeply divided. And we have a big job to do here. Forget the Middle East. You have a big job to do here in trying to educate people about why democracy is important and what you have to do to preserve democracy and not take it for granted. By saying that it's all Western, you're taking it for granted. Not only are you saying that other people are not qualified for democracy by experience or interest, that's what one of these candidates said recently, but you're saying somehow that we're naturally democratic. Really? In Germany, naturally democratic? And other countries, in Spain with the Spanish Civil War, naturally democratic? It takes a long, difficult time of working out the struggles and the conflicts. And to finally reach an agreement that if we're going to live together without killing each other, we're going to compete politically and not with violence. Yes. Thank you.
A couple of comments.
Why don't you get the mic?
But to democracy, too, is all we look in the mirrors, the corrupt nature of people when you're a young activist and then become middle-aged, not so active sometimes, but I'm thinking the greatest perhaps universal structure which saves us is perhaps the family. Even if Mao's great leap forward is much more dangerous than the Cultural Revolution where he's trying to tear apart families. But I can think of in Hitler's Third Reich, there was some guy who's a teenager and he brought home pictures of Hitler
What do you think about that? That's a question.
The question is then, because in his case, he had to bring home a picture of Hitler, and his mother said, what a wonderful picture. We'll put it over here in the stove and so on. And pretty soon it was covered with grease and so on. And then he realized that his mother was saying something. So I'm wondering, do you think then that people are having the family structure? Does that perhaps?
I agree. No. Look, we're not going to change current trends. And the family structure is greatly weakened, and I think that's very serious. Religion has weakened. You know, Tocqueville thought that religion was fundamental to democracy. We're not going to reverse that. But we have to think very, very hard about what we can do to try to renew our own democracy. There's a new book out by a scholar in Washington by the name of Yuval Levin about our fractured republic. And what he's talking about is sort of reviving a Tocquevillian sense of the importance of civil society and mediating institutions. So it's just not the individual and the state, which is terrible for democracy, but where you have various kinds of civic and religious, cultural, sports institutions where people from the bottom up work together. It also takes something from Catholic social doctrine, the principle of subsidiarity, where you try to bring authority down to the local level as much as possible and not put all the authority in the center. That's another thing which is important about democracy. Not concentrate power in the center, but bring it down to the local level and rebuild society from below. This is going to be very long term. And I would hope that we could get people coming from both the Democratic and Republican parties together who care about the future of democracy to start thinking about these types of issues and to start, you know, no longer just getting into the simple answers which become extremely partisan, but think hard about what we need to do to, if we can't, you know, I mean, we're not going to have a big religious revival. I don't see, you know, I really don't see the decline of family reversing dramatically, although I agree with you that it's extremely important. But we need to think, what can we do to help bring society and bring people together so that they're not isolated and atomized and victims of an all-powerful state? Yes, and then here, please.
Thank you. I just returned from a trip to Haiti, where I certainly did not see any evidence that all boats are rising, and where the popular perception seems to be that what stands in the way of a successful general election is us, the U.S.
In Haiti?
Yes, and what is perceived as our desire to recolonize Haiti. Could you address that perception, please?
Haiti has been, Haiti is an extremely, the poverty is enormous. It's an extremely difficult problem. I don't think the U.S. wants to colonize Haiti. Nobody would accept that. This is really long-term work in Haiti. How do you explain the difference between the Dominican Republic and Haiti? They used to say, by the way, that the Marines went to both countries, but they only left baseball in the Dominican Republic, not in Haiti. And maybe, I'm not being facetious about it, but it is going to be a very, very long and difficult process. But at the same time, what I have talked about other countries, those types of organizations and civic groups exist in Haiti. And they need constant support and nurturing, and it'll be a long-term process. A lot of it will have to do with economic development and better governance in Haiti. This is not, not all problems are the result of us. Some of them are the result of our neglect more than of our going in and making a lot of trouble. And right now we're in a period where nobody wants to go in anywhere. We have to find a proper balance here, but I don't think anybody wants to colonize Haiti.
For your remarks, just a couple of quick thoughts and then a question. There seems to be, both in Western liberal democracies and in the quote-unquote developing world, a rise of either nativism or secular religious uprisings or divisions.
Secular religious uprisings?
Religious...
Sectarian.
Sectarian
religious conflict.
Yes. So, absent the geopolitics that were in place after World War II that sort of maintained the borders in the former colonized world, What will resist the kind of tendencies of human nature toward nativism and tribalism? Because we're seeing that resurgence, and absent a Cold War to enforce the pawns on the globe, what's going to kind of push that back? Because we see this resurgence, I guess, especially in the Western democracies, where because of the debt situation and unstable economies, you're seeing a retreat in terms of a willingness to kind of either project soft power or hard power.
Yeah, well, I mean, there are a lot of different issues there. The problem of sectarianism, I sort of addressed indirectly when I mentioned the wars of religion, and maybe we could think about the conflicts taking place in the Middle East ultimately running their course. I don't think, borders have changed, and even though, this is also, by the way, this week is also the 100th anniversary of the Sykes-Picot agreement, which set all these borders. I don't think anybody, aside from ISIS, really wants to get rid of these borders. And you have to, the trick is going to be to try to work out within the frameworks that we have ways of having peaceful, multi-ethnic, multinational societies. We have someone else on our board, Don Horowitz, who's really the leading specialist on these issues. And he's written about how do you build into electoral and constitutional systems incentives for compromise. So you don't have electoral systems where one group has all the power, the other group has nothing. That's a recipe for violence. But how can you build in? And what do we know about these things so you can build in ways in which people need to compromise with each? They need in order to get elected, you got to have the votes of that particular group. And you try to make it as fluid as possible so that people don't get locked into a majority or a minority, which can be a disaster. And there's a lot we have to think about that. And there are a lot of different models for this in the world. But these are really, really tough, complicated questions. I don't think the United States is really, maybe there is a real touch of nativism that we have today. I mean, look, we've had this before. We've had populism in previous periods. I think that will run its course, but there's going to have to be, we're going to have to come up with hard solutions to address real problems that people have. A lot of people have real economic problems today, and they feel neglected. And that opens the way up for demagogues who want to come along and appeal to their fears and their grievances, as I said. And the answer is not just to denounce the demagogues. The answer is to come up with real solutions to problems. And we need solutions at all these different levels. Economically, we need solutions, as I was talking about before, in terms of social relationships that we have in this society, rebuilding, thinking about even mediating institutions that people need in order to have identity, in order to, have more to rely upon than just themselves. I think we're at a period of a seminal turning point in our country, and we have to start thinking anew politically. And I think what's happening, I don't know that our party system is breaking down, but I think we need to think not only about new ideas, but also new relationships, new alliances, and to try to rebuild the center in our politics. Yes.
A democracy needs politicians or leaders in politics to lead it along. And it seems historically we've had great leaders. And I'm wondering if now, because of the rise, the explosion of the importance of polling, and frankly, self-interest and greed, do you think that our politicians now are fulfilling their role of actually leading the people, or are they following or leading for their own benefit?
Look, you have a decline of the kind of political leadership you're looking for throughout the world. Throughout the world. It's not, I mentioned before Václav Havel. The government in the Czech Republic today doesn't remember Václav Havel. The values that he represented are right now not in vogue. And we're going to have to think hard about how to revive those values. I think it has a lot to do with young people. It has a lot to do with education. It has a lot to do with rebuilding civil society.
It has a lot to do with ideas and therefore intellectual discussion. I think the Foreign Policy Association can play a role in this in really thinking of ways to reach the younger generation, but with real democratic ideas, not with just, you know, party politics or, you know, which politician is the best one or the worst or the least evil or whatever. But really start thinking and not taking democracy for granted, but realizing that it's something very, very precious, that it's very, very difficult, and that if you take it for granted, you're going to lose it. I mean, there was an abolitionist in 1858, Wendell Phillips, who said the price of liberty is eternal vigilance. So let us be vigilant. Let us not, you know, let's get off our butts and really start fighting for these values and talking about these values and reaching out to young people and others in America with, you know, start a discussion about what we need to do to revive democracy in our own country, which is then so important for democracy in the world. Thank you.